My name is Father Driscoll. I'm the parochial vicar, which means I'm the assistant here at the cathedral. Nice to have you. Welcome. Beautiful day. It's not raining. I keep telling people that I prayed for rain for 2.5 years. Whenever I had an opportunity, there's a section in the Roman Missal that says for rain. So I would pray that whenever there wasn't something else that was prescribed. So I've stopped doing that, and it seems to be working. It's all about me, right? But this year, 2017, I'm praying for more priests and religious. We need them, and I told the story maybe last week, but in the town of Lo, Italy, in 1887-ish, the mothers got together with the priest and started a prayer campaign for vocations, that God would open the hearts of the young people that he wants to love in such a special way to serve him with their whole lives and serve the brothers and sisters. So over the next two or three decades, in that town of 1,000 people, 300 vocations appeared. Started the Seed Church in its 120-year history, produced 400 vocations, one of whom is here with us, Sister Noreen. And so we want to pray that we have more people. And Pope Benedict, in one of his homilies at a first mass for priests, reminded us that vocations come when the people are united, when the church is united in prayer. So please keep that as your intention. So our series continues when you leave. There'll be a basket if you like to help pay for the sound system, and other things. But this flyer that some of you already know is over here if you want to take one and share it with our future speakers. Next week is a great talk, which I'll mention at the end of the series. I welcome my good friend now, Father Kevin Kennedy, pastor of Our Lady of Fatima, Russian Byzantine Church, Catholic Church, and also parochial vicar, are you, at St. Thomas the Apostle and St. Monica parishes. Father has a great history in the church, a great love for God, that you just can't help but feel whenever you talk to him. And so we're very excited to have him here to talk to us today about his topic is Zacchaeus, the Publican, and the Prodigal Son, conversion stories from the Gospel of Luke, Lent with the Byzantine perspective. So welcome, Father Kevin Kennedy.
Thank you so much. It's good to see all of you. I see old friends from Belmont, Redwood City, and people from the various parishes where I've served and am serving, so I'm very appreciative of your presence. As together, we continue our Lenten pilgrimage, and it's the journey to Easter. It's the journey to Pascha, as we say in the Russian Christian tradition. Pascha, the Slavic word for Passover, the Lord's passage from death and through death to life, to new life, to life in abundance, to life that will never end, to life in the Spirit. And so we enter into that journey together, each of us together, as we ponder and reflect upon the Word of God, as we enter into the mysteries of Christ, especially centered around the Eucharist and the prayer of the Church, on works of penance, charity, humility, forgiveness, all of these aspects of Lent that prepare us for the great transformation, which is the Easter event in our lives. When I was growing up, now this is a recap of a talk on Byzantine Lent that I gave a year ago, and I'm going to expand on that. So some of you might have heard, if you went to that talk, I give a lecture on Byzantine Christianity the second Saturday of every month at Our Lady of Fatima. And if you went to that talk, you're going to hear some of this, but it will be in a different format and expanded. So if you haven't been to any of those, this will all be new. Something old and something new. The something old is what I can remember Lent being when I was growing up. And it was very task-oriented. It was kind of about what I'm going to do or give up for Lent. And it was focused a little bit on self without even realizing it. And so if you were not good about Lent, you felt kind of bad about yourself. But if you were good, and, you know, as a little kid at least, I wasn't too naughty yet, so I was fairly good about Lent. I was fairly good about observing what I had decided to give up. And, dear diary, today I did all the things I was supposed to do. Thank goodness. Pat yourself on the back, you know. Dear diary, today I had no candy. How many more days left before? And there was a bit of a danger to that. What would the danger be? Pride. Spiritual pride. After 40 days, whoa, good for me. Yay, I did it. Spiritual champion, I gave up See's candies for 40 days. I'm a saint. Really? There's a self-centered aspect to that, at least at a subconscious or subliminal level, and a focus again on, or a danger of, pride. Spiritual pride can be worse than any other kind of pride. And so in Byzantine Christianity, we prepare for Lent weeks ahead of time. And we prepare ourselves to fight against, to be warned about, spiritual pride. In the old Roman Rite that I grew up with, what is now the extraordinary form of the Roman Rite, the traditional Latin Mass, we had, and some of you might remember this, that Sundays before Lent, Quinquagesima, 50 days before Easter, Sexagesima, Septuagesima, and those were eliminated in the ordinary rite, the new form, the Novus Ordo or the Roman Mass. They're kept in the traditional Latin Mass. And the Byzantine Church has something like that in the sense of preparation, a more remote and then proximate preparation for the beginning of Lent itself. We don't have an Ash Wednesday. People are surprised. You don't have an Ash Wednesday? I thought you're Catholic. Yes, but we're not Roman Catholic. We're Byzantine, Russian Byzantine Catholic. So we're fully and equally Catholic, but we prepare for Lent in a different way. And the popes, certainly since Vatican II, have encouraged Roman Catholics to familiarize themselves, you know, like get out of your own backyard mentally, and familiarize yourself with other forms of Catholicism that are very ancient and beautiful and venerable. So our form is a focus throughout Lent on fasting, a focus on discipline. It's basically our fast. It's an ideal, but our fast would be the old pre-conciliar, pre-Vatican II Trappist fast. I mean, if you observe it fully, you can basically have water and grass. So you do your best. You do the best you can in terms of giving up meat and dairy products and wine and oil and all the rest. But because of that focus on the ascetic dimension of Byzantine Great Lent, there is, again, that danger of spiritual pride. And so the church, going back centuries, the Byzantine church has prepared people, not so much to encourage them to fast, but to warn them, to prepare them. Be careful how you fast and your motivations for fasting and where you will end up after the fast, whether more humble or spiritually proud. And so we have, as was the case in the traditional Latin Mass, weeks that prepare us for Lent. And we have five of those weeks. The first three of those five, a more remote preparation, are Sundays that are dedicated to the gospel event for that Sunday that I'm going to be speaking about today. And they were chosen precisely because they address aspects of our relationship with God, the journey to God, the danger of spiritual pride, and what Lent is actually supposed to do for us and within us. Not what we do for ourselves, but what God does for us. So the first of these Sundays is Zacchaeus Sunday, and we read the gospel of Zacchaeus, and we reflect upon it. Just let me read it to you briefly here. He entered Jericho and was passing through it, and a man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. And all who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house, because he is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." It's a powerful story. That's why the church invites us to reflect upon it, again, preparing to enter into Lent, a remote preparation. What does it tell us? What does it teach us? What does it warn us about in terms of ourselves in relation to the Lenten journey? The first thing that it tells us about is in terms of encounter. My encounter with the Lord has to begin with my real self. My real self, not my idealized self. The self that I was talking about as a child that wanted to do absolutely my best, like running on the track team or getting A's in your report card or something like that. I can do this. I can do Lent too. I can get an A in Lent. I can win the race. Is that what Lent is all about? The idealized self. The self that a little child can fantasize about. Being numero uno, being perfect, being the best of the best in everything all the time. There's something in us that kind of wants to conjure that up, even as children, very competitive. And there's a good aspect to that, a motivational aspect at times in our lives. But with regard to our prayer life and our relationship with God, it's starting off on the wrong foot. And it's running in the wrong direction. St. Augustine once said, "You might run beautifully, very well, very fast, but in the end, what does it matter if you're going in the wrong direction?" What is the right direction? Zacchaeus gives us a key. Zacchaeus doesn't have an idealized self. That's the key. As he's described in the gospel today, there's no ideal Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is a crook. He's a crook because he's a tax collector for the Romans. So he extorts, he asks for more than he should. And the other thing about him, he's short in stature. He's a short little guy, and so he's not up to par in terms of what men of that time would see in terms of physical height. Zacchaeus has a real self that he starts with in the encounter with Jesus, not an idealized self. There are shortcomings to Zacchaeus, and yet those shortcomings become the impetus, they become the means by which everything about Zacchaeus' life is changed. Zacchaeus comes as a sinner. Zacchaeus comes as, quote unquote, less than, not better than everybody else. He comes in his real self, not the idealized self. And so, in a sense, he comes waiting for something, for someone. Not to do everything for him. That's the passive dimension, very necessary in the spiritual journey. But there's an active dimension as well. Yes, God's love wants us to
to simply receive that love as gift. It's harder than we realize sometimes. The passive dimension of trust, of absolute confidence in God. But God's love is not unilateral. No love is. It's bilateral. It requires of us a response. Seek and you will find. Seek and you will find, as we hear in the gospel. What does Zacchaeus do that nobody else in that crowd, who's not a crook and who's perfectly the right height as far as men were considered their height in those days, don't do? They're interested. He's interested, unlike the others, in seeking the Lord. He wants to see him. There's something in him that inspires him from within. Who is this Jesus? Maybe he could change my life. And so he climbs the sycamore tree. And Jesus looks at him. He doesn't look at all the others. He doesn't look at the others. He sees Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is real as he is, with all of his faults and failings. That's heart to heart, the encounter that happens. Zacchaeus is himself. The spiritual life is like a party where you're invited and it says underneath, come as you are. Come as you are. Which is a way of saying, be real. Be real. Jesus knows who we are anyway. We don't need to make believe or pretend with him. Come as you are. And if you do, you'll never be the same again. And so the Lord says to him, come down. Yeah, you, Zacchaeus, come on down. I must be in your house today. It's not just saying I want to have lunch. I know you're rich, you could put on a good lunch for me. No, the house is a symbol of Zacchaeus' life. And remember, the humanity, the sacred humanity of the Lord is filled with what? What happens at the baptism? The Spirit hovering over the Lord. In his humanity, he becomes a Spirit bearer, which is the very grace of God, the life of God. To have Jesus look you in the eye is to be seen by God, made man, God in flesh, God one with one of his own creation. It's a human look that connects with your humanity, but it's more than just human, it's divine. And so it will change you from within in ways that you could never imagine or even hope for. You'll never be the same again. Imagine his look, imagine his smile, imagine that heart, imagine those arms opening up to receive you and lift you up. Imagine that glance as he looks and says to Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus, calls him by name, you, irrepeatable, you, unique, Zacchaeus, you, just as you are, you, yes, you, I must come into your life, not tomorrow, no, now, today. If today you hear the voice of the Lord, harden not your hearts. Zacchaeus' heart explodes with joy, with love. He climbs down. He's so excited. Notice everyone else's response. Everyone else. Good people. Very good people. They're not crooks. They're very virtuous, no doubt. What do they do, though? Do they rejoice with them? No, they grumble. That's the word used. They're grumbling. And they're grumbling against the Lord. Doesn't he know what he's doing? Doesn't he know this guy's a crook? You can't have lunch with him. And Zacchaeus has had an authentic encounter with the Lord. If he was just the same, the Lord left him as he was, then the Lord would be a fake, a fraud. But he's the Son of God, made man. And so his heart reaches into and melts the heart of Zacchaeus with the very Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God. And that changes Zacchaeus. He's filled with joy, a warmth, an inner warmth in his heart. And he doesn't just say, I'm a terrible sinner. He knows. Yes, he knows what he is, but he wants to change, and the change is instantaneous. He says, I'm going to do this and this and this. I'll get back everything fourfold. And he's not saying it in a grudging way. He's happy. He'll never be unhappy again. He'll never grumble like the others ever again. He's happy. He's happy because he's experienced this love of God, this love of the Lord. And so he is invited into his house. And he receives him, and Zacchaeus will never be the same again. A synergy, we call it in Byzantine Christianity, of wills. God gives us a gift, the gift of love, which in the face of our human misery, in the face of our sins, in the face of our deepest needs, becomes what? Mercy. Mercy itself. Mercy upon mercy. A merciful love. But that's not unilateral. We have to say yes to it. We have to receive it. And Zacchaeus receives it, and it changes him because he wills that change. He says yes to that change. Encounter and transformation, the synergy of wills, and the joy that all of that brings. That's a marvelous model of our Lenten journey. Much more than giving up See's candies and recording it in my spiritual diary. Dear diary, today I was so good. As always. See you tomorrow. This is different. This is the real self coming as I am. And yet be open and willing to allow the transformation that the Lord is able to make and wants to make in my life happen. So we move then from Zacchaeus Sunday and its lessons. By the way, these Gospels are kind of like, you know, they're giving us a common theme. They're each different, but there's this common theme of what it really means to be on the Lenten pilgrimage. It's kind of like if you've ever seen a movie more than once. I used to love, if I liked a movie back in the old days, of course you couldn't record anything, you just go and see it again. And the second time or the third time, if you really liked the third, fourth, you saw a movie, but the third or fourth time you saw something that you didn't quite get or see in the first time or even the second time. And so we get these quote-unquote movies week after week after week, these gospel passages that tell us something to remind us again and again of what Lent is really all about. So after Zacchaeus Sunday, then, we move to the parable of the Pharisee and the publican. What is the main theme? If encounter and transformation is the main theme in Zacchaeus, what is the main theme in the Pharisee and the publican? Some of us look at ourselves and say, well, which one am I? We're a little both. And that's the point. But there's something about the publican that's, again, real rather than artificial. If you look at the passage, the Pharisee begins, and they're in the temple, they're praying. But the Pharisee is praying by himself. By himself. It doesn't just refer to a physical posture that everybody's here and I'm somewhere on the other end of the cathedral over here by myself. It means he comes in an attitude of selfishness or self-centeredness that separates him not only from others but from God. He's praying to himself. He's not praying to God. He's saying, he begins to pray to himself saying, oh, I'm so thankful that I am, and then he goes through the laundry list. The good things that we should do if we're going to observe a rigorous Lent are the kinds of things that this guy is applauding himself for. Dear diary, I was perfect again today in this. I was A plus on this and A plus on that. A minus maybe. No, I'll give myself an A. I better do it tomorrow. And boom, 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 boom. And all of these things are absolutely correct. He's not exaggerating. He's righteous. He's following the law, observing all of these commandments and statutes and decrees of the Lord. But he's doing it on his own, by himself. There's something about him that's cold inside. isolated, something lacking kindness, something lacking love. The publican comes, and there's a completely different attitude. Not only physically, he's down on the ground, he won't even raise his eyes. But he comes as I said earlier, as you are. Who is he? He's a sinner. There's something in him that says, the only things I really own are my sins. Everything, absolutely everything else I have is a gift from God. And in dependence upon God, in awareness of that fact about God's providential care and love, in awareness of who he is by himself, alone, with God alone, he says, have mercy upon me, a sinner. He's not depressed, it's not morbid. You know, he doesn't need therapy or medication. There's something real about it, however. Not despair, but life-giving, because he's not talking to himself, he's talking to God. He's not alone. He's the whole human race summed up in a single heart, if we would join that heart. And what is that heart? The heart created by God for heaven, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. What is the key to that kingdom? Someone asked St. Thomas Aquinas that question. What are the three important virtues, essential virtues to get into heaven? What's the key? What are the three essential virtues? The University of Paris, someone asked him this. Well, he said the first essential virtue is humility. The second essential virtue is humility. The third essential virtue is
humility.
Wow. Is that groveling in the dirt? Is it being psychologically depressed? A focus on self, despair, that focus leads to? No. Humility, according to St. Teresa of Avila, Teresa of Jesus, is simply self-knowledge. Simply self-knowledge. The Pharisee lacks that self-knowledge. He thinks he's God. Wow, I'm God. Look at how wonderful I am. God, I really am. For real. Oh, not like the schmuck next to me. Thank goodness I'm not like him. And he leaves the temple alone, the way he came in. All by himself and everything all about himself. Whereas the Pharisee, whereas the publican leaves righteous. And so we have a choice in our Lenten journey in terms of our conscious and subconscious attitudes towards self and towards others to choose the key to heaven. Then we move to the following Sunday. And that Sunday moves us in closer proximity to our Lenten journey. And we focus on the prodigal son. The prodigal son, we've all heard that story. I won't read it because we're all familiar with it. The two sons are contrasted, of course. The first son asks for an inheritance before his father is even dead. The second son, of course, is angry after the younger son has returned home. He blew it. He blew the inheritance. He has no money, no food. He's desperate. And so, in a kind of calculating way, he says, oh, I suppose if I go back, I could be hired as a servant for my father. That's the motivation. He's hungry. He's desperate. So he goes back. And of course, the father sees him from afar, embraces him, and brings him home. Puts on him the robe, which is a festal garment, the ring, which is a symbol of authority. His status as son is restored as if it had never been lost. And the fatted calf slaughtered, and a marvelous feast. The son, of course, hears the sound of music, and like the people surrounding Zacchaeus, he grumbles, more than just grumbles, he's really angry. I've been so good. And he has been, like the Pharisee in the temple. He's been very good. He's done all the right things. He's been competent. He's been efficient. He's been responsible. He's been the good son. Look at his diary. My goodness, it's full of all kinds of compliments to himself over the years, year after year after year. How dare my father do this? It's not just. It's not right. And the father simply says, I love you. I've always loved you. Everything I have is yours. But your younger brother is back again. He's back. And so we must celebrate and rejoice. Two sons in our gospel. And in every retreat that I've done focused around these two sons, especially preparing for Lent, and in every homily it seems I've heard decade after decade, it falls short somehow. If you were to ask yourself, who is a caring, giving person focused upon others, willing to go the extra mile? Do either of those two sons fit into that category? No, neither of them. Who fits into that category? The father. And yet in every Lenten retreat I've done or other kinds of retreats based upon the gospel of the prodigal son, we've all tried to calculate what part of me is the younger son? What part of me is the older son? We use the Enneagram in the old days to do that. My personality type, my profile. Me, me, me. The message of this gospel is, it's not about you. Wow. Wow, that's good news. Because when it's all about me, what a burden. I have to psychoanalyze myself. What part of me is the younger son? What part of me is the older son? How can I improve? How can I change? How can I negotiate these aspects of my personality, the weak parts and the strong parts of my personality type? Me, me, me. Oh my goodness gracious. I'm back to the diary again. Dear diary, focused on self in my Lenten journey. That's a consequence of original sin, you know. It's an artificial construct called the ego, self-manufactured. We call it that in the post-Freudian world, the ego. And we're born with it. Bette Midler was a comedian in the 1970s. She was not always reverent, but she was very funny at times. She used to have a comedy act in her clubs, and she used to say, when I was a little girl, when I was an infant, the first words out of my mouth were not mommy and daddy, but me and more. Me and more, me and more, me, me, me. And that can translate into the world of religion. You become religious, a spiritual vice. St. John of the Cross taught that. You get rid of the external vices, the obvious vices, and then you get the spiritual ones, spiritual avarice, spiritual gluttony, spiritual lust, spiritual envy. And that's the danger of Lent. That's the danger of being hyper-religious, is because you think you're someone that you're really not. and you're focused on yourself. And so, again, movie after movie after movie, gospel after gospel, we finally get to the prodigal son. And the real good news is that it's not about you, and that you don't have to worry about what part of you is the younger son and what part of you is the older son. Forget about you. Don't think about you anymore. That's the liberation of the good news. What's the point of this? The Father. Why do we want to think about those two sons? Let's look at the Father. What a grand and glorious focus. The Father's love, a prodigal love, a prodigal Father. He just loves you. He brought you into being. You didn't create yourself. You're redeemed by God, sanctified by God. And that sanctification, that grace, is not something quantitative. Again, dear diary, I did 5 very good virtuous things today, and I got this grace and this blessing and this indulgence deposited immediately into my spiritual bank account. Another good Lenten day. Tomorrow will even be better. It's qualitative. It's a relationship with God. It's receiving this prodigal love. Prodigal meaning the Father gives and gives and gives. He has gift itself, life and light and love itself. He loves you before you could manufacture anything about yourself, make up anything about yourself, spiritually apply cosmetics and make yourself as best as you can be. He sees you as you are. He loves you as you are. Come as you are. The spiritual life begins with reality, the real self, not the idealized self. And when I come as I am, I allow the Father into my life, and then suddenly I'm liberated from having to think about myself, because he's much more interesting than me. He's life and light and love itself. And so a true transformation begins to take place. That holiness, that growth in holiness, someone said the formula for holiness is the transformation, the radical transformation of my center of interest from myself to God. That's what Lent is all about. The transformation of my center of interest from myself to God. I can still have the religious self counting up blessings and graces and good deeds that I've done, and I'm still focused on me. Forget about you. It'll feel great, actually. It's very liberating. And focus on something, someone else. How about God? Starting with God. Because if I focus on God, then all other good things are given with God. And so this relationship, this journey to God, which is the Lenten journey, a lifetime journey, not just a season throughout the year, begins with humility. It begins with coming as you are. Humility is self-knowledge. I am not God. And only God can relieve me of that inner restlessness that Bette Midler was talking about. Me, me, more. Because that's a restlessness that will last all your life. How do I get liberated from that? Even spiritually liberated from my focus on my self-advancement spiritually and my own imagination. I'm liberated by love. That love which in the face of my need for God becomes mercy. Divine mercy itself. And then I have the possibility of something, someone other than me to focus on. And who better than God? Who better than God? And then I want to talk to God. I want to get to know God. We call that prayer. And we say prayers. Especially we say a lot of prayers during Lent. But St. Teresa of Avila once again said that the best prayer, I mean, we're taught the liturgical prayer, of course, is the center, the Eucharist, communal prayer, and our devotional prayers. But there's also a need for mental prayer or interior prayer, St. Teresa called it a heart-to-heart conversation with God, who you know loves you. How do I know he loves me? Because I came as I was, like Zacchaeus and the publican, and he accepted me. And he lifted me up, and he taught me what it is to love by loving me. Humility is the foundation, and prayer sustains the relationship begun by the foundation, by the first encounter with the Lord, a heart-to-heart conversation with God, who I know loves me. And then, having received that love into my life, into my heart, I begin to share that with those around me. The following Sunday, after the Sunday of the Prodigal Son in Byzantine Christianity, is the last judgment. It's the last judgment. The depiction of the last judgment. We have that on, we had it a few weeks ago. And the gospel is from Matthew 25. We've all heard this gospel. All of the nations are assembled, all the peoples. And the Lord begins to depict that judgment in terms of relationality. He's not saying, let me see your diary, your spiritual diary. How many A's did you give yourself last Lent? Focus on self. He's asking, did you notice the poor? Did you notice the sick? Did you notice the hungry and the thirsty and the naked? Did you visit them? Did you give them something to drink? Did you clothe them? Did you give them something to eat? When? Because if you did that, you did it to me. If you didn't, you didn't do it to me. When, Lord? If you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. If you failed to do it to the least of these, you failed to do it to me. Only love that we've been prepared to understand at a deeper level through Zacchaeus Sunday and the Publican and Pharisee Sunday and the Prodigal Son Sunday has led us to that point where now we can understand that to be loved in such a way as Zacchaeus and as the publican and the prodigal son, which is to say, loved as God loves you, yes, you, is a love that allows me then to love everyone else, to see, to notice, and to care about those around me. And then judgment isn't about some future date or event. And I need to worry about when will it happen? What grade will I get on that day? Judgment is every day. Judgment is every day. Judgment is the love in your heart. If you've been loved by God, you've been healed. The real self has encountered the real Lord. And he brings what only he can bring, healing to shame, to brokenness, to woundedness. Enlightenment. I'm not alone. God's on my side. He's with me. And transformation. I want to be one with him. I want to be one with him, the love of my life forever. And that transformation is sealed by the sharing of the love that I have received from him with those around me. On the following Sunday, then, we haven't even gotten to Lent yet. Much more than just getting a smudge of ashes on Ash Wednesday. This is week by week by week by week preparation. The final Sunday before the first Sunday of Lent, we call Forgiveness Sunday. And I'm going to do this so you might be able to not get it on camera, Ryan, but that'll be okay. On Forgiveness Sunday, we have the Divine Liturgy together. It's the last Sunday before the fast, the full fast begins from meat and cheese. And then we come together as a community for forgiveness vespers. And the priest, the pastor, and he's not wearing light vestments, by the way. These are the Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, heavy vestments. He comes down in the midst of the community. And he kneels down. And he says, forgive me. Forgive me any way in which I have harmed you. Wow. When's the last time your priest or your pastor did that? We do that as part of preparation for Pascha. And the community says, we forgive you and may God forgive you too. You were there. 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 Many of you have been there and seen this. And then they come up and each person embraces the other, kiss on both sides, forgive me. And each person says, I forgive you and may God forgive you as well. It's good. It's a long service. Person after person after person. It's not just a sign of peace. Yay, slap you on the back. This is a real part of preparation for Great Lent. And it's the culmination of all of these Sundays. I saw this movie. Now I really get it. Gospel after gospel after gospel after gospel after gospel. Then we're ready for that event, for Forgiveness Sunday. And then our hearts are prepared to enter into the Lord's journey to Jerusalem without spiritual pride that would ruin everything. It's not a matter of what I give up. It's a matter of who I'm in love with and who wants me to follow him in his love. That leads to complete self-emptying, pouring out in humility, a heart broken so that ours might be made whole, wounded so that ours might be healed, a heart filled with the love of his passion, and to be there so that when they say, were you there when they crucified my Lord, I can say yes. I was there. I was there not because I'm good, not because I'm perfect, but because I'm not. And he loved me anyway. And because of that love, I love him. And because of that mutual love between him and I will never be the same again. I want to follow him. I want to serve him. I want to be one with him. Not as a task, not as a duty, but as a sacrifice of love from my heart to his, giving back to him who has given everything to me and who has given me a love that I wish to share with the person right next to me in concrete and real and very practical ways, day by day. And so that is Byzantine Lent. That culminates in a glorious celebration of the Triduum, Holy Thursday, Holy Saturday. On Holy Saturday, we have a tremendous celebration in the morning of the descent of the Lord among the dead. So on Saturday, there's a full liturgy in the morning in the Byzantine tradition that the Lord has come down to among the dead from the tomb spiritually before the resurrection and announce the good news of this love that heals and liberates the souls of all who have been awaiting that liberation throughout the centuries, the fulfillment of the ancient messianic hopes and promises of Israel, ancient Israel. And then we have a grand celebration of Pascha that evening. It's about a 3.5-4 hour liturgy, but we are renewed and refreshed in the Lord. Not despite, but through the cross, we come to the resurrection. That final victory, that triumph over self, the victory over the me and the more that I might still want to cling to. The victory of light over darkness, the victory of holiness over evil, the victory of love over hatred, the final victory of life, God's life, over even death itself. And so may that victory be yours and ours together as we continue our Lenten journey, our pilgrimage to Easter. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with us forever.
Amen. Amen.